Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You just tuned in to another edition of the Sports Shop 27. I'm your host, Jermaine Colter. And to my far right, I got Kevin Johnson, KJ. And today's special guest, we got former Clemson basketball FIBA ball player, Rayfield Ragland. How you doing, Ray?
What's going on?
Hey, man, that intro was better than my pro days. That's pretty good. I like that.
Wow.
I appreciate it, man. So for the people who don't know you, let them know where you're from and a little bit about your background, big guy.
Well, Rayfield Ragland from Florence, Alabama. Florence, Alabama is right at the Mississippi and Tennessee state lines, top left corner of Alabama. Been here all my life. You know, when I finished playing ball, I came back here. Been to take care of mom and dad, so I'm gonna be here for a minute.
That's what's up, man.
That's good, man.
What age you started playing basketball?
I started playing basketball when I was 5 years old. I'm 49 years old now, and I still like to say that I'm still active around the sport because I'm still training kids and doing a lot of things with the sport. But I started playing when I was five, and I ended my actual basketball career when I was 36 years old. But I'm still active, you know, in the community, working with a lot of kids, getting them developed for basketball as well.
Okay. So who was the first person to put the ball in your hand, Rayfield?
My oldest brother. You know, I like to tell people, when you have a model to follow, if you pay attention to that model and you watch what they're doing, whether they're doing something right or whether you're doing something wrong, if you pay attention to that model and then take everything that they're doing right and then continue to build off those things, then you transform as an athlete. So my oldest brother, I watched him at a young age with a basketball in his hands, and so I just kind of followed his footsteps after that.
Okay. For a lot of the people that don't know, go ahead, KJ.
Yeah, did you play any other?
I played football. I played basketball. I also ran track. So I did. I did four sports total. I was always active around sports. Always active. Always outside in the yard. You could catch me in the backyard doing stuff all by myself, just pretending that someone was around me. And I was always in the backyard doing something with sports.
That's what's up, man. Sound a little bit like me. But let me ask you a question. So you played four different sports in high school. What age did you start playing all four of those sports exactly? Like, was it 1 year after another, or was it like all like doing 1 year or one season?
Well, it started when I was pretty much 10 years old because I went first from basketball to football, and then from football to baseball. And those first three sports started when I was 10 years old. And then once I actually got to high school, my ninth grade year, I was pretty fast. So my coaches advised me to run track. So I ran track and field. But I started actually playing three sports when I was 10 years old, but started playing four sports when I was a freshman in high school.
Cool. So who are some of the athletes you looked up to besides your brother during those times?
Well, when I was coming up through high school, there was a lot of guys in this area that was, you know, pretty good athletes. Back in my day, we didn't have, you know, what kids have nowadays with social media, you know, all the energy drinks and all the protein shakes and all this stuff. So everything that we saw at my age, you know, a lot of athletes got it natural. So one guy that always stick out in my mind is a guy in this area named Carlos Campbell. He actually went to my high school and he went to Auburn and played football at Auburn. And he was the running back, you know, next to Bo Jackson, you know. So he was the one guy in this area that I actually looked at, you know, when it came to football. But then when you talk about basketball, it was a guy in this area that was named Rodney Jarman. So there was a lot of guys in this area that kind of paved the way for me. I watched them a lot.
Okay, cool. So in baseball, did you pitch any?
Well, I was a pitcher and a center fielder. I had a pretty good fastball, so I was a pitcher and a center fielder in baseball.
Okay. Out of the two positions, which one was your favorite?
I would say center field because I got to stand still. Didn't have to do a whole lot. But as a pitcher, you know, you're constantly – Okay. As a pitcher, you're constantly moving, throwing, doing stuff. But center field, you're just kind of standing out there all by yourself, letting everybody else do the work until a ball come out to the field to you.
Yeah.
So in basketball, you was always a forward, or did you play guard starting out?
Well, I was always – it's a funny story because, you know, coming out of middle school, I was already 6'4".
Wow.
Going into high school, I only grew maybe another inch or two, so I was automatically a post player. I didn't make the transition to actually being a guard or being able to have to step out on the ball until I got to Clemson. So all through my high school career, I was a forward slash center until I got to college, and then I had to make that transition to actually learn how to handle the basketball and being a player that actually played the perimeter. So I like to consider myself a late bloomer because I didn't polish myself at that position and actually until after I left Clemson.
Okay.
Yeah. So did y'all win any state titles in high school? Any state titles?
We got close. Year after year, we got close in football. We got close in basketball. We even got close in baseball, but we never just got over that hump to where we won a state title. Would have been nice, but we just never won one.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in football, what position did you play?
I was a quarterback. I was a 6'5", 215-pound quarterback that ran a 4.4 40. I had a 4.4 speed, so I was a big quarterback. And the thing about me playing quarterback, when I signed with Auburn out of high school, Pat Dye came here and told me that he didn't per se want me as a quarterback. He wanted me to play wide receiver because I was 6'5", I could jump, and I had the speed, you know, of a running back. So I ran a 4.4, so I was going to play wide receiver at Auburn.
Like a Vince Young or something.
Exactly, Pat Dye.
That's like Vince Young or Cam Newton. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Cam. Yes. That's right. Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, she was on my team.
Man, I learned a lot of things over the years that I would actually do a little bit different if I knew then what I know now. You know, playing four sports was great, but I never perfected the sport because I was always bouncing from one sport to the other. If I played one sport, I think I would have been really dominant just in one sport.
And what sport would that would have been if you would have changed anything or you would have stuck with what you did?
It would have been baseball, and simply because I got drafted twice to play Major League Baseball. So I know that if I really concentrated on that sport as a pitcher, then I probably wouldn't be here talking to you guys right now. So if I can do it all over again, everybody asked me why didn't I play baseball, but it was basketball because basketball is my first love. But if I could do it all over again, it'll be baseball.
Cool, man. So talk about your recruiting process. You were, highly recruited in four different sports. I know you probably had a bunch of letters coming. Name some of the schools that were recruiting you at the time and talk about your recruiting process and why you chose Clemson.
Well, and it was pretty much in football. It was every school in the SEC was after me in mixed positions. Some wanted me as a defensive end. Alabama, some wanted me as a wide receiver, some wanted me as a quarterback. So it was pretty much every school in the SEC. And then in basketball was actually my weakest sport. You know, I tell people all the time, baseball was my first sport. Then it was football, but basketball was actually my weakest sport. But I still ended up at Clemson playing basketball, which is kind of weird with that being my weakest sport. But in baseball, you know, I had a lot of offers from the SEC. A lot of ACC offers. In basketball, I didn't have a whole lot of offers, which is why I should not have chosen basketball because I ended up going to a junior college to play basketball and then left that junior college and then went to Clemson. And why I went to that junior college is because the scout that drafted me wanted me to go up to a two-year school and then play and then come that next year to play baseball. But I ended up signing a scholarship and going to Clemson and staying at Clemson and playing basketball. Should have chose baseball, though.
Man, so you get there to Clemson, you playing against team North Carolina. You got E Park on trial. Oh, can you hear me now?
Okay, I hear you now.
Can you hear
I lost
me? You. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I lost you.
Okay. Yeah, okay, cool. All right. So you go to Clemson and you play ACC against dominant teams like North Carolina, Duke, play against competition like Tim Duncan, Cherokee Park, Eric Montrose. Talk about that era of basketball in ACC and the level of competition that you had to face.
I mean, it was rough.
Can you hear me?
And like I said, I came out of junior college, high school and junior college, and I never actually, polished off my athletic skills when it came to basketball because I always played so many different sports. So once I got Clemson and I'm going against, you know, guys like Grant Hill, Antonio Lang, Bob Searle, Travis Best, and having to step out and guard some of these guys – now, all of a sudden, I'm sitting here like, you know, because I never really polished off myself at that particular position. So it was a shell shock for me to go against a lot of those guys in the ACC that was top-notch athlete that went on to have professional NBA careers.
Cool. So when you get to Clemson, who was the player that took you under their wing?
Wayne Buckingham. When I first took my visit to Clemson, Wayne Buckingham was actually my host while I was at Clemson. So the whole time we was there, it wasn't so much of him showing me the campus. He treated me like I was already there, like I was his little brother. So when I actually signed my scholarship there, it was because of Wayne Buckingham. I wanted a chance to play with Clemson's first ever All-American. You know, he coming out of high school as a high school All-American. He was one of the most dominant post players in the nation, you know, but he had a knee injury that year before I actually got to Clemson. So when I got to Clemson and took my visit, I said, I want to play with this guy. So Wayne Buckingham, you know, great friend of mine to this day. He's the reason why I ended up choosing Clemson.
Wow, that's good.
That's what's up, man. So I got a, I got a clip for you. I want you to check out real quick. You guys played Duke.
Take us back.
Go ahead and take you back real quick.
Yeah, let me put my specs on.
Down by eight. He doesn't want to go into the ACC tournament with a loss. Oh, Rayfield Ragland. Yes, sir.
Hey, we got some hops out there.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? The finisher.
Yes.
Yeah, that Matt
so
Harper.
Break that play down, you know, for us a little bit, Ray.
Well, Matt Harpring from Georgia Tech is the guy that was guarding me. And I knew that my foot speed was better than his foot speed. And Rick Barnes, who was my coach, he knew that I could pretty much take Matt Harpring, who went to the Utah Jazz, he knew that I could take him off the dribble. So instead of me just running down the court, the coach put the ball in my hands for me to bring the ball up the court. And he told me if I could blow by him, to just blow by him. I ended up just blowing by him and getting to the basket.
That's good, man.
Hey, was he talking junk?
You guys went to
I said, was he talking a little smack to you? No.
Well,
you
in the beginning of the game, everybody kind of tried to feel each other out a little bit. But it's those moments in the game when you can get a finish like I just got, and then you can look at them and be like, I got you. You know, right. So it was a little trash talk going on.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm trying to see the camera right here. So you play in the ACC tournament. Who do y'all play in the first round?
In the first round, my first year, we got North Carolina. That was in the very first round. Yeah. I mean, we had my last year at Clemson. We had Sharon Wright, who was our best player that year ended up going number six in the draft. And Devin Gray, rest in peace, Devin Gray. Devin Gray ended up, you know, having a heart attack before his senior season. So we was missing one of our best post players, you know, my senior year. Okay. So here I am, 6'5", 6'6", having to guard guys like Tim Duncan, Rasheed Wallace, you know, some guys that's 7 feet tall, Joe Smith that played at Maryland. So we was considered the smallest ACC team ever to come through Clemson my senior year. So my first year going into the ACC tournament, we got North Carolina. We ended up getting put out of it against North Carolina, the first round of the ACC tournament. But we was undersized. Sure. You know, the highlight of our year year, my senior year, was when Clemson was 10-0, Duke was 12-0. We go into the first round, the first game of the ACC, and we ended up beating Duke at Duke. That's the last time Clemson beat Duke at Duke was 1995. So that's the highlight of my career, was Clemson going into Duke and beating Duke on their floor at Duke. Yep. You know, so that's the highlight of my career, because to this day, Clemson has not gone into Duke and beat Duke at Duke.
Hey, it's hard to do, man.
Yeah, it is. Camera indoors. Mm-hmm. So can you explain the difference between the competition now in the ACC versus the competition then?
Well, if you look at the evolution of basketball, I mean, it's completely different now. Meaning, if you look at the ACC when I played, you had the typical post players who stayed down on the block. They posted up. They banged on the inside. Now with the evolution of basketball, you got a lot of ACC players or big men or in the Big Ten or wherever, you know, they able to step out, handle the basketball, and shoot threes. So the evolution of basketball – yeah, the evolution of basketball has changed tremendously from when I played. It's like when you look at, you know, some guys now in the NBA, you got 7-footers, you know, handling the basketball, bringing the ball down the court and shooting threes and doing everything else. Back in the day, you know, it wasn't like that. They camped out under the basket.
That's right.
Mm. You're right. The big man stayed in the post and never came out and shoot a three. If he did that, he was coming out quick.
Out the game.
Yeah. So you think the guards are a little bit more skillful versus bigger back in your day?
Yeah. I mean, nowadays they have to be. They have to be now, because you got so many guys that are able to step out and guard a smaller guy. So now the guards, per se, the typical 5'10", 6 foot, 6'2 guard, have to be a little bit more crafty with what they're doing to be able to get around bigger defenders, which means they got to shake them up and get them off balance a little bit better. So even the guard play has changed a lot. You know, now you got guys that can bring the ball down, shake and bake, make different combination moves to get to the basket. But those combination moves are only trying to shake a defender to get them off balance so they're able to get around their length. Because a lot of guards now, 6'5", 6'6", 6'7", 6'8", the smaller guards – have to be able to step out on a deeper range and shoot three. This is why you got Steph Curry, CJ McCollum, and all these guys stepping out 5 to 8 feet off the three-point line and letting it fly. And that's only because they're trying to take away the length of the bigger guards.
Go ahead, KJ. I think you had a question for him.
So how was the pro career? How was that?
How was the what? My pro career?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was, like I told you, I was a late bloomer, which means I never really perfected my actual position until after I left Clemson. So once I finished at Clemson is when I actually had that time to really concentrate on being a 1, 2, 3, or 4 and not just a 4 or 5. So my pro career really didn't take off until about my third year on the pro circuit. That's when I was able to get to my natural position and actually play the position that I trained for. But when I tell you, European play is completely different than the play here in the U.S. because here in the U.S. it's more fast-paced, up and down the court, real fast, real fast. But over in Europe, it's more structure, which means it's more set plays, a lot of half-court sets. So I had to take a lot of time to actually learn how to play basketball. When you're freelancing and you're running up and down the court fast breaking, you don't really have any set plays. So you just out there running around using your athletic ability. But in Europe, you got a lot of set plays. It's more slow paced. So now you have to know how to play basketball because you're working in half court sets.
That's great. That's great. That made you more dimensional as a basketball player.
So did you adapt to their language?
Hey, KJ.
I know it's kind of difficult, you know?
I'll tell you what I did. I ended up not having someone to teach me the language, but I would watch television every day. And I would watch the same shows every day. Not like regular television, but I would have like a DVD or something. I would watch it in English. And then I would come back the next day. I would watch that same movie in French with the English subtitles. And then I would watch it in English with the French subtitles. So it took me probably about 7 months to actually learn the language because I would study by watching television, you know, reading it in French, okay. Hearing it in English, hearing it in English, but then reading it in French. So that's how I picked up on the language. So it took me about 7 months before I actually picked up on the language.
Cool, man. How many years did you stay overseas?
14 years. 14 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. Getting the chance, you know, just getting the chance to play basketball and see the world and, you know, doing something that you love to do. Yeah, it was fun. It was fun.
You still talk to some people overseas? You still communicate with them?
I do. A lot of my old teammates, we still kind of, you know, talk a little trash to one another, you know, calling each other old and, you know, you can't jump as high as me. You can't run as fast as me no more. You know, that kind of stuff. But I still keep up with a lot of my buddies.
Yeah,
that's good, though. Cool. Yeah. You still talk to other players from Clemson as well, correct?
Wayne Buckingham.
Point guard, number 10.
Yeah, Wayne Buckingham, Sharon Wright, yep. Lou Ritchie, Andre Beauvais, Greg Buckner. You know, these guys I still kind of communicate with. And we still kind of got that open line of communication where we still kind of reach out to each other from time to time.
Okay. Did you make it to the playoffs in FIBA EuroBasket?
Yes, we did. We actually won the Coupe de France. My sixth year when I was in Europe. So we won one championship when I was in Europe.
Did y'all get some gifts, anything for winning?
Well, you know, they don't give out, you know, like the big trophies or anything. They give out the medallions, like the medallions that go around your neck.
Medals.
Yeah, yeah. That's what they give out to you over there in Europe.
That's different.
Cool. So you play 14 years over there. You won one, you know, championship. After you did that, what was next after you left basketball? What did you do then?
I think it's a funny story, man. In 2006 is when I ended my basketball career. I felt like I was 36 years old at the time. I felt like I was still at the height of my potential. But in 2006, the doctor told me that my knee was rubbing bone against bone and that I would, you know, all the cartilage in my knee was gone and that eventually I would have to have a total knee replacement. So I ended my career to try to prolong the longevity of my knee. So in 2006, I ended my career. And then when I got back to the U.S., I missed basketball so much. The second year after I was back, I started working with athletes. And my very first athlete was a girl by the name of Sarah Puckett. And she started with me in the second, going into her third grade year. And she has trained with me from second, third grade year all the way up until now. She's a senior at a local high school here. And she just signed to play basketball at the University of Tennessee. So she'll be a lady volunteer.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Good.
So now I work with, I think last time I counted, I got 417 athletes that I work with here in my area. So that's what I do now.
You also train in every sport, right? Or just particularly basketball?
No, it's every sport. The name of my training business is called All Sport Training. So I have baseball players, I have football players, soccer players, You know, I have players in any sport. If any parent called me about their child playing a specific sport, I would train that child for that sport.
Wow. That's great, man. You have your own personal trainer, in particular the position, and you actually an expert and professional, have all the experience. So if you're listening, viewers, you need your child to be trained, you need to hit up Rayfield Ragland. He got you. If you're in the Alabama area.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So talk about some of the kids that just signed this year from your training facility.
Well, this year, so far, the only one that has come out with a major big-time scholarship is Sarah Puckett that's going to University of Tennessee. There's some other players in the area that got some local junior college offers, some Division II offers. But the biggest profile name is the girl Sarah Puckett that's going to University of Tennessee. I have a football player right now that's at Auburn University. His name is Cameron Stutz. He's a lineman at Auburn University. There's another football player here that I worked with a few times. His name is Armani Goodwin from Trustville High School here in the Birmingham area. He's now going to LSU. Keep watching him. He's going to be a phenomenal running back for LSU this year. I had an athlete that just graduated from Murray State. She was a softball player. So I have a lot of athletes that has transitioned from one sport to the other and went on to college. So I'm hoping that they're going to also make their, you know, be able to get to the next level and play a professional sport.
Cool. So I have a clip right here showing you training, I guess, a first grader or a second grader. Let's check it out real quick. It's pretty neat.
Putting in that work. Let's see it.
So that's pretty neat, man. You got the hand-eye coordination working with the behind-the-back pass, working on the motor skills and the feel for the ball, keeping your head up. And he's only in the first grade, man. You got that career handle already.
Yeah.
Well, see, that's the big thing that I do with a lot of athletes first is to get them to first be patient. When I put them in a situation where they may panic, now it's going to teach them to be patient. She's working good hand-eye coordination. She's working on the bounce of the ball, which means she has to listen for the rhythm and timing. And the biggest thing is the hand and eye coordination and to not panic as she's doing the drills. But she was in the first grade right there, and I now still have her. She's a sixth grader now.
Oh, man. She's probably averaging about 15, 20 points a game right now.
She's going to be a good player.
That's good. That's good, man. So what would it be a typical workout for a baseball player? I know it's a lot of stretch bands, resistant bands, and things like that.
Well, the thing that I tell a lot of people is this. Everything that I do with every athlete in whatever sport that they play, I never per se involve weights. And let me tell you the reason why. If you think about a skillet of cornbread, if you cook a skillet of cornbread on high, that cornbread is going to brown on the outside, but it's still going to be kind of doughy in the middle because it's not cooked. Okay. This is what happens when you lift weights. You build the outer layer of the muscle, but you don't get on the interior fibers of that muscle. So everything that I do with a lot of athletes, I work a lot of resistance bands, because if you think about resistance bands, resistance bands are therapeutic. Every time you go to a rehab center, you see a lot of therapists using resistance bands. And the reason why is because those resistance bands build that muscle from the bone or from the tendon out, which means you're building the muscle the right way. So everything that I do with every athlete, if it's a baseball player, football player, volleyball player, I stick them quickly to those resistance bands. And then whatever sport that they play, I cater the exercises to build them in the sport that they play.
Cool. So after a hard day's work, is there any like treatment, ice baths or anything like that?
Well, we just make sure that they stretch a lot. You know, I have some football players that come and, you know, they do a lot of what we call cryotherapy, which means they go and they get in like this, you know, have an ice bath or they do some stuff like that. Yeah, freezing. But the biggest thing is just, you know, reminding a lot of athletes to continue to stretch. You wouldn't believe how many injuries actually happen because a lot of athletes don't stretch. And I constantly stress the importance of stretching to a lot of my athletes. So that's one thing I want them to make sure that they continue to do. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Cool, man. So you got your fitness center. You won a championship. Average 13.1 points at Clemson. Average 26.2 points in EuroBasketBall. Played four sports in high school. Had scholarships from all over. Where can these people find you at, Ray?
On social media you can find
and all these platforms if they want to work out with you.
You can find me on Twitter. It'll be Rayfield Ragland. It'll be All Sport Training. You can also find me on Facebook at Rayfield Ragland. That would be All Sport Training as well. You know, I'm here for every athlete. I like to train. It's one thing that I do. It's my livelihood. I study and I perfect my craft. I have an anatomy book this thick that I've gone through about seven times. So I take what I do serious. You know, if you have an athlete out there that's looking to get work, you know, please come my way.
Highly recommend.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So any camps or anything that you do, you do any outside work outside of your facility? Any consultations with star athletes?
Well, I have four athletes right now that I work with, you know, for a number of times that's now playing professional basketball in Europe. So I still kind of counsel them and I still kind of work with them. But as far as like the basketball side, I work with a lot of high school teams, a lot of middle school teams here in the local area. I have a lot of basketball clinics that I actually do. I don't do a lot of basketball camps. And the reason why is because I like to work alone because I can't really trust everybody's mind. So, you know, I kind of work alone and do a lot of basketball clinics, not camps, but I do a lot of basketball clinics with a lot of, you know, school programs here in the local area.
Cool, man. That sounds awesome. So we appreciate you coming on the show, man. It was a great time having you on. Learned a lot of stuff. Didn't know a lot of things about you. Well-rounded guy. Would love to have you back on the show. If there's one advice that you can give a student athlete right now in today's society, what would it be?
If I could give any information to any athlete, that would be to not let anybody tell you that you can't accomplish something. Everything that somebody has done in this world, it all started with them first having a dream. The same way they have telephones built, somebody had to start with a telephone, thinking of the idea. Someone had to think of the light bulb by thinking of the idea. So whatever sport you wanna play, you gotta apply yourself and think that, you know what, if he can do it, I can do it as well. You know, there's been nobody in the state of Alabama right now that has gotten four Division I scholarships in four sports. I'm the only one. I'm waiting to see if there's anybody in America that has gotten four Division I scholarships in four sports. I'm waiting to see that. I haven't heard it yet. So the thing that I tell a lot of athletes is this. You can be as good as you want to be. All right? You just have to make sure that you apply yourself, put in the work, and then continue to chase your dream. You know, if you don't chase a dream, then you might be chasing a nightmare. All right. A lot of things can happen for a lot of athletes, but a lot of things are not going to just be given to you. You got to go out and work for it. If you want it to happen, you got to make it happen.
Right. Yes, sir. Most definitely. Mm-hmm. Thanks for coming on, man. Can you got something to say? Go ahead.
Name your top five NBA players, man, or top three.
top. Woo! I can't shy away from Mike, Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
Kobe Will Bryant. Chandler? Not Wilt. If I would say Kobe Bryant, Michael Jordan, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Woo, the hook shot.
Because I started watching Kareem at a young age.
Yeah.
Lakers. Everybody was a Laker fan growing up.
Dr. J was good, but Dr. J was one of those players that could score around the basket, you know, real easy. But when you think about Kobe Bryant, when you think about Michael Jordan, they could score outside, the mid-range, and score around the basket. And then when you talk about Kareem and play defense, and when you talk about Kareem, I mean, you're talking about a defensive player, and you're talking about somebody who's pretty much unstoppable, you know, around the basket, one of the premier big men to ever play basketball.
Cleared it up right there.
So you went to JUCO. Name some of the people that went to JUCO with you that end up going to D1 and went to the NBA or went to FIBA. Do you have any JUCO partners that you still talk to as well or went to the league?
And you know, man, what's funny, that's one thing I tell a lot of the high school players now is that a lot of your friends that you have in high school, you all going to scatter like flies once you graduate. A lot of my partners that I play basketball with in JUCO, there were some of them that went to some Division II schools, but no one, when I was there, actually went to a Division I school. I was the only one to leave the JUCO and go to a Division I school. And once we graduated JUCO, everybody just kind of scattered like flies. You know, there's one other guy. His name is Fred Spencer. He ended up going to Troy State. But at the time, I think Troy State was a Division II school. But other than that, I mean, we all scattered like flies. You know, I don't hardly ever even, you know, talk to any of them. And I don't even see any of them. I just pray and hope that everybody's well. All I have now is a lot of memories of them.
Cool, man. Well, we appreciate you coming on, Rayfield, man. We'd love to have you back on. You already gave your message to the world, what you would like to see from student athlete. Is there anybody you'd like to shout out before we leave?
Man, I want to give a shout out first to you guys for allowing me this opportunity to come on your show to speak about some things, you know, about myself, to speak about some of my athletes, and just to speak about some things that athletes need to be doing. So my first shout out goes to you guys. My next shout out is going to go to Harold Coleman.
Thank you.
For, you know, having him tell you guys about me. So shout out to Harold for, you know, letting you guys know something.
Yeah. Yes,
sir. All right, man. Yes, sir. Well, you guys have tuned in to another edition of Sports Shop 27. I'm your host, Jermaine Colter. And to the far right, we got Kevin Johnson, KJ. And we would like to thank today's special guest, former Clemson basketball player, former FIBA Euro basketball champion, Rayfield Ragland. All right. Yeah, until next time, tune in. Also follow us on Spotify, Deezer, and YouTube, and wear your mask and be safe. All right. Cool. All right. Next time, we'll see you. Peace.
Bye.